Good morning, church. As I came here this morning and I was praying, and this is what the Spirit of God prompted. In a worshiping God, let us understand, let us not box ourselves in worshiping Him. Because Moses tells Pharaoh, I don't know how we are going to worship. So when Pharaoh said, take men, leave your cattle, leave your women. And this is what Moses said. I don't know with what we are going to worship the Lord. So I just want to be ready, prepared, open in worshiping God. Amen. Number two, as we worship the Lord, let us not box God. Let us not limit God in our worship. And see, one of the names of God is He is beyond. He's beyond understanding. So when we worship Him, let us not have a limitation. Let us not put our God in a frame. Let us not put our God in a box. And thirdly, as we worship, we have a God who is there to bless us. Let us not limit God by saying, Lord, do this or do that. In other words, let us not limit God by taking a vessel to be blessed. That will be limiting God. So when Jabez prayed, he prayed, Lord, bless me, Lord. And he said, so he didn't say, make it, 4 groans, 5 groans, or 1 acre, 2 acre. He didn't mention the measure. He gave it to God. He said, you enlarge my territory. So you know how you're going to bless. So as we worship the Lord this morning, please understand, let me not box myself. Let me not limit myself doing that. This is how I'm going to do it. This is what I'm going to do it. Yes, we have some songs. Yes, our God is a God of order. At the same time, in our mind, let us not limit ourselves. Let us be open to worship the Lord. Number two, let us not, box our God. He's a God who is beyond understanding. Let us not limit. Today we might get a new revelation. Amen. Thirdly, let us not have a box or have a container saying, Lord, this is where you need to worship. And when King Joash, when he struck the ground 3 times, Elisha got really mad, really upset. And he said that you have stopped it 3 times. And you guess what? You'll only be delivered. You'll only have victory for 3 times. So never do that. Amen. For which Psalm 73 verse 17 says, until I went into the sanctuary of God, then I understood. See, there are a lot of questions psalmist had. Psalmist had many questions and of the things which is happening around. So many questions he had. How does the wicked prosper? How is it, they are all fine and I'm aching and suffering and hurting? And all these questions, he didn't find an answer. Verse 17 says, then... Verse 16 says, when I thought how to understand this, it was too painful for me. So when I think about certain things, I really get depressed. So instead of thinking elsewhere, when I come to the sanctuary of God, to the presence of God, I get understanding. Hallelujah. So this is a time and a place you and I can get some understanding. Shall we all rise up to our feet and worship the Lord? Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, we come into your presence in Jesus' name. Lord, this is a presence where, Lord, we can get a new revelation. Lord, this is a place where we can get an answer. Help us not to box us, box you, or to go to your presence with a box. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Help us to understand that you are a spirit and we need to worship you in spirit and in truth. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Father, many times, Lord, we just worship with our body, with our carnality, with our limitation. This morning I pray that, Lord, that you would take charge. Whatever you desire to do amongst us, that you would do. Whatever you desire to do in my life, that you would do it, Father. We commit ourselves. We love you, Lord. Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Let this be our prayer this morning. Draw me close to you. Draw me close to you. It's a simple song. I just want all of you to raise your voice and sing. Let us all pray this prayer. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Else can
little babies, infants, they know what they want. Amen. Yeah. Others will come. Sometimes the mother is busy or sick and unable to carry, but the baby wants the mother. So others will come, you know, grandmother will come, grandfather will come, uncle, aunt, you know, husband, others will come. Mm-mm-mm-mm. They would try to give this or that to the baby. You know, the baby is absolutely positive what the baby needs. Sadly, we are all, you know, grown-ups, right? So very easily, we can be distracted. The song we sang was, Lord, you're all I want. Can we come? That's why Jesus said, you know, you want to come to the kingdom, enter the kingdom, come like little infants, come like little babes. Amen. Hallelujah. Let us continue to worship the Lord in the reading of Psalms.
Praise the Lord, church.
Praise the Lord.
Today's psalm reading is from 111. Psalm 111. Psalm 111. I will read the first verse, second verse congregation, and last verse we will read together. This is a psalm of praise.
Amen.
Praise the Lord. I will praise the Lord with my whole heart. In the assembly of the upright and in the congregation.
The works of the Lord are great, studied by all who have pleasure in them.
His work is honorable and glorious, and his righteousness endures forever.
He has made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion.
He has given food to those who fear him. He will ever be mindful of his covenant.
He has declared to his people the power of his works in giving them the heritage of the nations.
The works of his hands are verity and justice. All his precepts are sure.
They stand fast forever and ever and are done in truth and uprightness.
He has sent redemption to his people. He has commanded his covenant forever. Holy and awesome is his name.
The fear of the Lord
fear
is the
Lord
beginning of wisdom.
Beginning
a
of
good
wisdom.
Understanding have,
good
all,
understanding
those
have all those who do
his praise
commandments
forever.
His praise endures forever. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Good understanding is with those who do his commandments. Amen. Let us not be just hearers of the word, but let us be doers of the word. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us all sing together an old hymn, Standing on the Promises of God. Hallelujah. That's the only thing, you know, we can rely on, which is very, very stable. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Standing on the promises of Christ, my King, through eternal on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God. Standing on the promises that cannot fail. When the howling storms of heaven assail, by the living word of God I shall prevail. Standing on the promises of God. Standing, standing, standing on the promises of God, my Savior. Standing, standing, I'm standing on the promises of God.
On the promises of God.
Amen. the promises of God, my Savior, standing. I'm standing on the promises of God, standing on the promises I cannot fail, listening every moment to the Spirit's call, resting in my Savior as my all in all, standing on the promises of God.
I don't know how many of you remember VeggieTales. VeggieTales, where, you know, Bob the Tomato. Okay, Bob the Tomato. You know, there's a problem, you know, because Bob the Tomato, we don't know whether it's
sitting or standing.
Many times we are like that. No one knows whether we are sitting or standing. No one knows whether we are firmly established in the Word. Hallelujah. The Bible says, you know, this psalm, a good understanding of all those who do His commandments. Please understand, when we are firmly grounded in the Word, amen, the Bible says you and I will not be moved. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let's continue to worship. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Wherever the need arises, the grace of God arises. Every day we rely on the grace of God. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, hallelujah. This morning, you and I, you know, for us, the grace is enough. Amen, the grace is enough. Amen, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let's clap our hands and praise Him. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Great is your faithfulness, O God. You have stood us in the fire. You lead
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Once David was, you know, in a hurry, you know, because for a long time David was running like a vagabond, you know, literally running away from Saul. Every day he'll be in another place. So once it was where he had to just leave a place, he didn't have whatever he needs, the basic necessities. He didn't even have a sword, nothing to defend himself. So he goes to the priest, and there he eats the bread of the priest. Even Jesus refers, you know, about this in the New Testament. And later on, you know what? He's asking for a sword, and do you have any sword? Anything, you know, I need something to defend myself. And the priest comes and gives what? Goliath's sword. Wow, that's good enough. That's good enough. Hallelujah. Have you come to a place where God gives you something and you can say, wow, that's good enough? There's one thing all of us can say, Lord, your grace is enough for me. Come on, wonderful. You know, this is good enough for the day. This is good enough for the week. This is good enough for the month. This is good enough for the year. It's good enough for my family. It's good enough for my lifetime. Hallelujah. Your grace is enough. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Church, the greatest commandment is to love the Lord our God with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. Amen, 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 amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, we praise you, Lord.
Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. With all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength, with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, with all your strength. I will serve the Lord with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind.
You know, we say this, we sing about this, but I wonder whether we do this. I wonder whether we do this. You know, for us, you know, yes, I'm doing it with all. It's we don't use all. We don't use all. We don't use all our strength, all our mind, all our soul. Amen. Hallelujah. In Mark chapter 14, verse 8, we read about Mary coming and doing, you know, loving Jesus, expressing her love towards Jesus. And in that, Jesus makes a statement saying that what she did, what she could. It's a very simple, ordinary statement. It says, she did what she could. What did she do? She did three things. You know, it was a congregation of men. You know, she was not permitted to come. And she, you know, she has a very bad reputation in that particular town. She had all the limitations in her mind. She went past her limitations, which she could. Amen. Every time, you know, we come, you know, we need to make sure that no one calls me, no one upsets me, I don't have a slight headache, you know, everything is fine. Only then I'll be able to come to God's presence. Church, yes, we can. Even when there is a headache, yes, we can. We go to college, we go to school, we go to work. But coming to the house of God, you know, we don't do what we really can. We don't use all our mind, all our strength. Amen. Hallelujah. Then we see, you know what? She came and she, what did she do? She gave the best. She gave the best. It was not just anything. She gave the best. Hallelujah. It was a very expensive perfume. Let's not give the rest. Let's give the best phrase. Hallelujah. Then we see that she gave it all. She completely opened, broke it, and gave everything without any reservation. Church, as we worship the Lord, let's do it with all our heart, with all our soul, with all our mind, and with all our strength. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Here I am. The best worship you and I can give is to offer ourselves. Hallelujah. Here I am, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you. grace has found me just as I am. Your grace has found me in my lodeba. Your grace has found me in my lodeba. When you read the story of Mephibosheth, having lost everything, having lost his family, having lost his pride, having lost all his privilege, having lost all his pleasure, amen, having lost his personality, he's a lame guy, he's in a forsaken place, guess what? Mercy of David found him. Mercy of David found him. I don't know about you. God's mercy found me in my wretched condition. Psalm 40, we see that when I was in the pit and when I was in the mire, I called out to him when no one, you know, was there to help me and no one was able to help me. He lifted me up from the miry clay. He lifted me up from the miry clay and helped me to stand on the rock to stay. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Master, we love you. It's an awesome thing to remember, Lord, to respond to your grace. Yes, Lord, here we are. We are here only by your grace. And so many people, when so many nations right now in our lifetime, when they are confounded, when they are limited, when they are struggling, when they are lonely, when they are depressed, you have brought us nigh to your presence. You have given us the liberty. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, yes, I was glad when they said, let us go to the house of God. Amen. Hallelujah. You have given us this joy. You have given us this joy of fellowship. Lord, to have fellowship with you and the saints. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lord, help us not to take these things for granted. Lord, help us not to take your grace for granted, Master. Amen. Hallelujah. It's your pure grace. We love you. We thank you for your grace. Thank you for your mercy. We love you, Jesus. We exalt you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Please be seated.
Amen. Hallelujah. This morning for our meditation, I would like to turn your attention to Psalm, the book of Psalms, chapter 50, verses 1, 2, and 3.
The mighty
one, or the Lord, has spoken and all the earth, from the rising of the sun to its going down. Out of Zion, the fortress of beauty, God will shine forth. A God shall come and shall not be silent. A fire shall go over before them, and it shall be very tempestuous all around them.
Well, who wrote this song?
Asaph.
Do you see any caption over there?
Asaph.
Asaph. Asaph has written this, and church, I know for sure that you are well versed with this man of God, the singer Asaph, and he was a great singer and a musician in the time of David and Solomon. You know, First Chronicles chapter, we don't have to read all these scriptures, I just want to give you for your reference, First Chronicles chapter 15 verses 17 to 19. And 1 Chronicles chapter 16, verses 5 to 7. And then 1 Chronicles 25, 6, 25, 1. And 2 Chronicles 29, 30. All these scriptures talk about this man, the great singer and the musician. Well, he was appointed by David. Asaph was appointed by David. He and his sons presided over 24 groups. In those days, in the temple of God, there were 24 groups to sing. Amen. You know, and they used to sing in, turns. Yeah, thank you. So, out of these 24 groups, all of them were from the 12, consisting each of 12 from the tribe of Levi. And, you know, they conducted the musical services in the temple. So in each group, out of these, out of these 24 groups, four groups belong to this man of God, Asaph. So according to 1 Chronicles 6:24, he was also from the tribe of Levi. This is the first psalm. You know, there is a group of psalms written by this man from 73 to 83. If you see, all those psalms were written by this man of God, Asaph. But this is not included in that group. It is a bit aloof, but it has got something common, you know. What are the common things in his writings? Number one, he writes about God revealing himself, theophany. You know, how God reveals himself. The prominence given to God's judicial action. And the divine names of God, El, Adonai, Elyon, all these things, you know, are common in his writings. In this psalm also, you can see all these mentionings. But there are certain things that you don't see in this chapter, in this psalm. What are they? In each psalm, you would see some mentioning about David, some mentioning about Joseph and his heritage. But here, you don't see anything. It's a bit different. Well, why was this psalm written then? The scholars, they believe that this 50th psalm was written for an occasion to be sung during the festivity of the Feast of Tabernacles. When the Feast of Tabernacles was conducted, the priests were obligated to read the law which was written by Moses to the people and explain about it. And this psalm may have been written for such an occasion. That's what scholars, they believe. What is the emphasis of this psalm? You know, there is something very particular about this psalm. It emphasizes a fact. What is that? Godly living. You know, if you could put the whole psalm in a nutshell and, you know, and say, what is found in this? Nothing but godly living, amen, which, you know, that should result from the true spiritual worship. Godly living and true spiritual worship. They both go together. People with godly worship, people who worship the Lord in spirit and in truth, they will have a divine, godly living, a life which is acceptable and pleasing to God. Please take some time today when you go home to read the whole passage. Well, this psalm can be divided into four parts. Number one, God the judge summons the court. Verses 1 to 6. God the judge summons the court and confronts two offenders. You know, God is confronting with two offenders. Who are these two offenders? The formalists, to whom worship is a ritual. Why do they worship? It is a ritualistic thing. I go to a church on a Sunday because it is ritual. If I don't go to a service on a Sunday, then I'm not at all a Christian. You know, people who are formal, to whom worship is a ritual to follow. Verses 7 to 15, you know. And this psalm also talks about the hypocrites. Who's an hypocrite? And a hypocrite is the one for whom worship is a disguise to cover sin. Amen. You could see many people with a Christian name going to various places of worship, still living in sin. For them, the name of God is to conceal or to hide their sinful attitude and nature and activities. The psalmist mentions about it, verses 16 to 21. The psalm closes with a call to all worshippers to be faithful to God. 22 and 23. Let me go again and tell you. God the judge summons the court, verses 1 to 6, and he confronts two offenders, the formalists to whom worship is a ritual to follow, and the hypocrites to whom worship is a disguise to cover sin. The psalm closes with a call to worship to be faithful to God. Please read on verses 4 and 5 and 6. 4, 5 and 6.
He shall call to the heavens from above and to the earth that he may judge his people. Gather my saints together to me, those who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. Let the heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge.
You know, there is a mention about judge. How many times you read the word judge here? Hope you have noticed it.
2, 3, 4, and 5. Twice.
Six you read, then? 4. Well, turn your Bibles and see. How many times the word, the mention of the judge here?
Twice.
Thank you, Pastor. Twice you see, you know, the mention about the judge here. The holy judge. Human judges are called the honorable judges. You know, your honor. With the due respect, we call the honorable judge. But this judge is called the mighty one. That's how the psalm begins. Verse 1, please.
The mighty one,
God. The mighty one. Hallelujah. We have the honorable judges on this earth, but we have the mighty judge, the mighty one.
Hallelujah.
And he's present here. Amen.
Amen.
The mighty one. Well, Asaph, the psalmist, began by referring to God in terms of utmost majesty. He wanted to give the most glory and the honor to the God Almighty. He wanted to give him the best. Therefore, he says, mighty one. Well, the word El, the Hebrew word El, E-L, you know, stands for the might of God. And then he says, the mighty one, God, Elohim. Elohim is a plural form. You know, that speaks about the wisdom of God as well as his might. El Elohim and the Lord. Lord is Jehovah, Yahweh, is a title by which he is ever revealed in his grace. Well, let me quote again. The first three words in verse 1, you know, the Hebrew text which says, El Elohim, Yahweh. That is God, God and Lord. He is a mighty one. The psalm begins with a majestic heaping together of a divine names. Right? He is a mighty one. This God comes to Zion as he once came to Sinai. In the book of Exodus, when God's people came out of Egypt, you know, God wanted to speak to them and God wanted to give them some instructions about their way of life. So he descended on Mount Sinai to show his majesty and power. And the psalmist says he will once again come to Mount Sinai. And he will come to Mount Zion. What is Mount Zion? Where is this Mount Zion? This Mount Zion is a small mountain which is adjacent to Jerusalem, which was in the hands of Jebusites. When David fought with the Jebusites, he captured this place. Mostly, the Mount Zion was also in many times it is called as Jerusalem. And God is going to appear again, he says. And the Lord is sending some summons to the people for judgment. God's summon, you know, God is sending notices to his people. That is what you see in this psalm. God's notices, summon notices to his people. Why does he send this summon? To judge his people. As God assembled heavens and earth for the judgment, he did not begin among the nations. Please be sure that God's judgment doesn't begin with the nations, but it begins with the saints. The house of God. His people, his saints, those who have made a covenant with him in this by sacrifices. This morning, I have come here to talk to you about the judgment of God to his people. God's judgment. Many times we think, oh, on the day of judgment, he's going to judge us. But this psalm, you know, says he's the judge and his judgment is found even at present. He knows all those who are on trial. This judge is aware of everyone to whom he is sending his summons, me and you and all the people. He calls heaven and earth to witness the proceedings. Verse 1, verse 4 and verse 6, we see this judge wants some witnesses, and the witnesses are the heavens and the earth. When the judge enters the courtroom, what everybody does, you know, can anybody say what everybody does?
Stand.
They stand. They stand in, as a token of respect and honor. He is a honorable judge. But God's entrance into this assembly is accompanied by the shining of his glory.
Amen.
When a judge comes, everybody, they stand up. But when this judge, the majestic one, when he comes to the church, he is accompanied by the shining of his glory and a fiery tempest, not unlike the scene at Mount Sinai when he gave his law. When we forget the presence of God, we find it easier to sin. The ark was with the people on Mount Zion. You know, David brought the ark to Jerusalem, to Mount Zion. But the nation must not forget Mount Sinai, where their God revealed his holiness and greatness. Many times we talk about Mount Zion. Well, Emmanuel, God with us, wonderful. But we should also remember Mount Sinai, where God revealed his holiness. God is judge, and judgment begins with his own people. 1 Peter 4:17. 1 Peter 4:17.
For the time has come for judgment to begin at the house of God.
Mm.
And if it begins with us first, what will be the end of those who do not obey the gospel of God?
Mm. Who are they? They are the godly ones. That is, they are the people set apart exclusively for the Lord because of the holy covenant. If you read the Psalm chapter 50, you know, you could see the Lord has been long-suffering with them and silent about the matter. When they were sinning, when they were against God, God was just keeping quiet. Verse 21, please.
These things you have done, and I kept silent. You thought that I was altogether like you, but I will reprove you and set them in order before your eyes.
Many people, they think when God is silent, God is approving what we are doing. It doesn't mean that God is allowing what we are doing. In Tamil, there is a beautiful saying, Arasan Andru Kolluvan, Irevan Nindru Kolluvan. Right? The court of law would punish a person immediately. But the Almighty God will take time to punish someone. Now it is a time for God to speak. The purpose of this trial, why God is appearing as a judge among His people, not to punish you and me on the trial, not to judge and condemn you, saying that you are unfit, you are a sinner, and you know you are fit to go to hell. But God gives us an opportunity to repent and return to Him. Amen. That is why this judge, you know, he comes with majesty among His people to restore them. Hallelujah. Amen. This morning we have a judge in our midst, an unseen judge in our midst, and He is here to restore us. God is a God of restoration, and this judge is here, an unseen judge is here in our congregation. Well, if you see the Bible, there are few places where God's judgment is written about. The Bible talks about God's judgment. Okay. Number one, the judgment at the last day, which is found in Matthew chapter 25, verses 31 to 46. The judgment of the last day, where God will bring all the nations together and He will separate them into two groups, the sheep and the goat. We all know about it. On the right side is the sheep and the left side is the
goat.
Excuse me, I know I'm a teacher, basically. I teach Bible to the Bible students. So I have a habit of asking questions. So please don't mistake me. And if you could respond, fine.
Amen.
You know, that is an indication that you're following me. Right? You're following the scripture. I know that you are busy in taking notes. Okay. There are... God calls all the nations, and these nations, they come to Him for judgment, and God divides them into two. The judgment of the last day, that is called as the judgment of the last day. The judgment which is expressed in, you know, the providential dispensations on the Jewish church, the Jewish gathering, which is found in Jeremiah chapter 7, Jeremiah chapter 7 verses 1 to 20, and Ezekiel chapter 9 verses 4 to 6, God's judgment on the Jewish people, the Jewish gathering, the people who gather in the church, in the temple. The third judgment, or the judgment that are brought upon Christian churches that are unfaithful, that you are seeing now in various places. These are plainly enough shown us in the epistles to the seven churches. If you see the seven churches in the book of Revelations, God sends His judgment to each church. There is only one church which escaped from the judgment of God. Which was that?
Philadelphia.
That Philadelphia. Pastor says, that Philadelphia escaped from the judgment of God. God could not accuse anything with that church. Whereas with all the six churches, you know, God could see the good things as well as the lacking among those people. The fourth, the judgment that is going on in every visible church now. The judgment on whose eyes are the flames of fire and who walks in the midst of the golden lamps. Here, He's here. In the book of Revelation, you could see the Lord was walking around the golden candlesticks. You know, He was walking in between all the churches with a flame of fire, with eyes full of flame of fire, and His eyes could see all the hidden things of those churches. And those eyes are here, Hebrews chapter 6 and verse 1.
Therefore, leaving the discussion of the elementary principles of Christ, let us go on to perfection.
Let us go on to perfection. Hallelujah. God says, you know, enough is enough. Amen. Your imperfections, I am seeing all your imperfections. That is enough. Let us move on to perfection. This judge is saying this morning, let us move on to perfection. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Church, let us not get tied up with all our imperfections, with all our sinful nature, with all our backsliding, with all the worship which is not relevant to God at all. You know, many worship is just comes out of our mouth and lips. Many times we sing, Lord, I will die as a martyr for you. You know, I will shed my blood. In Tamil, there are so many songs. Rathame Sindhi Satchiyai Valvain. Lord, I will even shed my blood. But we don't shed our blood even if a knife cut, you know, on our finger. We get so much depressed. So much of blood has gone out, you know, I'm wounded. Where is our worship? Is it a real worship? These people, you know, who are they? The people who are church-going people, the religious people, the men and women, young men, who have been brought up under the influence of the word of God, and they offer sacrifices. God says, gather these people, people who hear my word, people who offer sacrifices for me. You know, in the olden days, they offered sacrifices of animals. But now we offer the sacrifices of our lips. Amen. We just praise God with all our, you know, being. And to them, God says, I am coming as a judge. God is here this morning as a judge to judge his people. God judges his churches. He will judge the sinners also, not now, but at the end, in eternity. But whereas the church is being judged now, in this life, the wicked will be judged later on. That's why 1 Peter 4:17 says, judgment must begin at the house of God.
Amen.
Beloved, we are here witnessing an invisible judge. A judge whom you and I don't see with our eyes. He's in our midst. He knows our attitudes and our actions. Even before the word comes out of our mouth, this judge knows everything. The psalmist says in Psalm 139, the whole psalmist says, where can I go? Where will I go from your presence, O Lord? The judge is here. That is why Paul says, for this reason, you know, we need to maintain a decorum in the church because the angels are watching. That's what Paul says.
Amen.
When he talks about, you know, women
covering
their head, he says, because of angels, you need to cover your head. In our worship, not only this invisible judge, but there are also angels worshiping along with us. Are we listening to the word of God with our whole heart? Many times, you know, preachers, they preach. The word of God is being spoken, but it goes above our head. We give an applaud, we give an appreciation saying, oh, it's a wonderful sermon. Pastor, you have given a very good sermon. But is it really getting into our heart? God is our judge. He is judging us. He is sitting here to watch us. He says, gather my people. The judge says, gather my people. Bring all those who are mine. God gathers his people in various ways. Number one, he gathers his people through their conversion. Through the change of heart. In the first century, when people received the power of the Holy Spirit, Peter began to preach. Acts chapter 2, when Peter preached, you know, we all know that 3,000 people accepted Jesus Christ as their Savior. They repented of their sins. And they said, we will follow this Lord. And you know, the Bible says, all those who were saved were added into the church. God gathers people, you know, in their conversion. And then we have come here to worship the Lord. God gathers people together for a worship, public worship. Even though we worship the Lord in an individual capacity at home, we come here to worship Him in a public way. He gathers His saints together to Himself during the time of danger. You know, He says, come to me, I'll give you a shelter. I'm here to protect you and shield you. The book of Isaiah says, come my people and enter into my chamber, the chamber of my perfections and my promises. Enter into thy chamber and shut the doors about thee and hide thyself until the calamity is overpast. God gathers just like a hen gathering the chicken. That's how the Lord wanted to gather the children of Israel when He looked into Jerusalem. He gathers during the time of danger. God gathers His saints together in the service of His church. God gathers people to serve Him during the time of Reformation. God raised certain leaders to serve Him. Martin Luther and Calvin, they were all a few leaders who were raised by the Lord to serve Him, to make some changes and reformations in the church in Europe. And He chose 12 apostles to do His service. He said, go and preach. God gathers people in the death and the resurrection. You know, He gathers people in our death. The Bible says, precious is the sight of the Lord. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of His saints. For God, you know, the death of the saints is precious. He would say, go death and gather such and such of my saints unto me, because they are precious ones. Go and collect those people. Go and gather those people who are dead. Just like a gardener entering into a garden to pluck the beautiful flowers, you know, God gathers His people. John chapter 17, I think it is verse 21, Jesus says, Father, I will that they whom Thou hast given me may be with me where I am, and behold my glory. And next, God gathers those who made covenant with Him. In this passage, verse 6, we see, gathered those people who made covenant with me. Covenant makers. There are two verses in the Hebrew and the Greek word which talks about covenant. One is berit, the other one is diatheke. Both talks about testament, you know. The Bible is a book of covenant.
Amen.
That is why you see Old Testament. Testament is nothing but a covenant. And New Testament. What is berit? Berit is something, you know, when you make a covenant with someone, the animal is cut into two portions. Right?
Yep.
Equally it is cut. And both the parties, they walk in between with an understanding. If you are not faithful, right, then our agreement or our covenant is broken like this. This will happen to you and me. I will kill you, right? In other words, I will cut you into two pieces. Diatheke is another Greek word. You know, berit is a Hebrew word, and diatheke is a Greek word, which says one man giving. You know, normally we need two people to make a covenant, but here in diatheke, one person is enough, and that person can give a covenant. Okay, I will do this for you. That's what Jesus did. When he took the bread and he took the wine, he said, come on, this is my new covenant.
Amen.
Right? Diatheke, you don't make a covenant with me, because whenever God and man, right, when they made a covenant, guess who will be dishonest?
Man
will be always dishonest. And God had to punish the human beings. But it went on for a long time. Then God felt, okay, berit is enough. Now let me switch over to diatheke. I will honor, you know, I will make a covenant on my name. What is this covenant? I will no more remember your transgressions. This is a new covenant. I will write my scripture on your heart, not on the plate. Well, beloved, now God is gathering those people who make covenant with them. In the book of Ephesians, chapter 2, verses 11 and 12, Paul says about our condition. Please read Ephesians chapter 2, verses 11 and 12.
Therefore, remember that you, once Gentiles in the flesh, who are called uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision made in the flesh by hands, that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenants of promise.
Enough. You know, the Bible talks about strangers. Strangers for what?
Covenant.
To the covenant. Paul speaks very clearly. We were strangers to the new covenant. The Jewish people were well versed with the old covenant, but the church, the born-again experience, was lacking in many of the Jews. He says, you were strangers to the covenants of promise. Now, please read verses 4 onwards.
He shall call to the heavens from above and to the earth, that he may judge his people. Gather my saints together to me, those who have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. Let the heavens declare his righteousness, for God himself is judge. Hear, O my people, and I will speak, O Israel, and I will testify against you. I am God, your God. I will not rebuke you for your sacrifices or your burnt offerings, which are continually before me. I will not take a bull from your house, nor goats.
I'm sorry, Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 onwards, please.
But God, who is rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses, made us alive together with Christ, and raised us up together, and made us sit together in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace in his kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast.
You know, thank you, brother. Now we have our access to the Father in one spirit. We are no more strangers, because we are washed by the blood of the Lord. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We are saved by grace. So we are no more strangers. We are no more aliens, you know, to the covenant. But we became saints. What are the covenant that we could, you know, the spiritual covenants that we all could make towards God? In the book of Genesis, chapter 17 and verse 11, Abraham had to make a covenant with the Lord, and that was a covenant of circumcision. You know, Abraham and all his descendants have to fulfill this covenant. All the male members in the Jewish community have to go and make a covenant with the Lord. But we have another covenant that we all have to make. Paul says in Romans chapter 2, verse 29, he says, but he is a Jew. Who is a Jew? Which is one inwardly, and the circumcision is that of the heart. A Jew needs a circumcision on his flesh, on his body. But a spiritual Jew, in other words, a born-again believer, a Christian, needs a circumcision in their heart. Hallelujah. God is going to gather all those who make a covenant with him, a covenant of circumcision in the heart. That is, the old heart, the sinful heart, you know, the wretched heart, it is thrown, it is removed, and with the grace of God, I get a new heart, right? The flesh has to be removed. And then we need to have a circumcised ears. Acts chapter 7, verse 51. Stephen says, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears. We hear a lot of things in our ears. You know, both ears listen a lot of things. We put a lot of feedback. Nowadays, you know, everything is on online. I know people sit from morning till night watching various, you know, YouTube messages and worship and whatnot. We need to have circumcision in our heart, not only in our heart, but also in our hearing. Don't use your ear, sorry to use this word, as a garbage basket. We all have a garbage basket at home. Where do we keep that? Pastor says in a corner, I suppose that we all, outside, yeah. You know, we don't keep all the garbage inside so that we could get a good aroma out of it. We keep it out in a corner, in a hidden place. But do we have a filter in our ears? Long ago, you know, when you fly in the aircraft, they will give you some cotton. If you request for some ear plug, they give you. They give you some cotton. And you can just put it. Why? So that you will feel comfortable when the flight is taking off and it is landing. The Lord says, I want to gather those people who made a covenant with me. A covenant of circumcision in the ears. Let us throw away, let us filter, let us block our ears from hearing all the filthy things, unwanted things, unholy, unscriptural things. And we need to remove that which is not useful. We also make a covenant with the Lord in our baptism. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 21. Peter says, right? Even baptism is like a covenant. Yeah. This morning, let me tell you, God wants to gather those people who made covenant with him. That's what Psalm 56, 50 and verse 6 says. He wants to gather all those, I'm sorry, verse 5. God wants to gather all those who made covenant with him. Have you made a covenant with the Lord this morning? The judge is here. And this judge is here not to condemn us, not to judge us, but he wants to say, well done. Well done, you have made a covenant with me. You are following Satan, you are following the sinful life. Now, you accepted me and, you know, you have come to the throne of grace. I have come here with my majesty, not to punish you, but to give you one more opportunity to come back with a real worship, to come back with the real sacrifices, to come back with a real covenant with me. Shall we bow down in prayer, asking the Lord, Lord, we have come here to offer you praises. We have come here to give you sacrifices, Lord. We have come here to worship you, Lord. We have come here to listen your word, O Master. But time and again, we make it as a formality, O Master. Coming to church is a formality for us. Listening a sermon is a formality for us. And worshiping you is a formality for us, O Lord. Change our tradition, change our formality into reality, O Master.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just when I started the service, you know, I was really prompted by the Holy Spirit to tell the church, let us not box God. Let us not box God. We box God to hear him say that, you know, I'm your friend, I love you, you know, God is gracious and loving. But this morning, you know, very clearly we saw that our God is our judge. Our God is our judge. And judgment begins in the house of God. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Let us understand these days, you know, you see the judgment of God. Just because I'm a Christian, just because I'm a pastor, that doesn't mean that God will not judge. Please understand, we have to acknowledge that God is our judge. And especially in this particular psalm, Pastor was mentioning two things, you know, God is, you know, holding against us. One is, you know, the formal worship, to hold on to the tradition. Another one is to be hypocritical. Hallelujah. In Matthew chapter 23, we see that Jesus, you know, when Jesus lived in the face of the earth, we see him, he was a friend of the sinners. He sat with the sinners. He sat and ate with the tax collectors. But when it came to the Pharisees, he was so much against them. He was so much against them because these two things, Pharisees were hypocrites. Pharisees followed just tradition. Pharisees were hypocrites. And they follow just a tradition. And Matthew chapter 23, he says, again and again, Jesus says, woe unto you scribes, you Pharisees. You know what? You just do it traditionally. You do it hypocritically. Church this morning, you know, God is speaking to us. Let us not worship God, you know, as a tradition. Let us not come and sit here and sing some songs because it's a Sunday, I need to do it. We have a God who is a judge. Hallelujah, hallelujah. At the same time, we heard that, yes, he's a merciful God. Church, let us set ourselves, you know, in alignment with the word of God. In alignment with the word of God. Hallelujah. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for reminding us that you are, yes, a loving God. At the same time, you are a righteous judge. Lord, you are a righteous judge. When you saw sin on your son, you do not spare your son, Lord. Help us to remember these things, Lord. Many times, Lord, we take not many things for granted. Many times we feel that you are just a gracious God. Yes, you are a gracious God. Help us also to remember that you will punish. Amen. Hallelujah. Help us to, Lord, fall. Lord, come in alignment with your word. Lord, we have come to the end times, Lord. We have come to the end times. Master, help us to set ourselves correctly so that we can be a living testimony, that we can be a living epistle, Lord, which people can read and get to know you. We love you, Lord. Bless your servant. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen.